Now, we were able to find David's PowerPoint. Did you want to just sort of give your quick conclusions right off the spot there?
Yes. So just a couple of the very brief points. So I talked about the pragmatic kind of a motivation. And it might sound a bit strange from an academic point of view to talk about a different type of motivation, to talk about chance, happenstance. But I think this is actually potentially quite important. Why did Qatar channel a lot of its support in Libya through Ali al-Salabi and to his brother Ismail and to Abdul Karim Belhaj? There's a sort, there, you know, lots of these reasons apply in different occasions, there's more than one. But part of it is that he was in Libya, excuse me, he was in Doha at the time. As the Arab Spring was starting in Libya, you know, he was on Al Jazeera talking about it. The diasporas are in the Gulf states are in a very important conduit of information and links. And it's just, as I say, sort of happenstance as to who is around. I think that's quite important. One of the other sort of conclusions is, apart from the, it can give a lack of operational unity, strategic unity, it can divide, is there is often, as we know, a lack of oversight. If you as a state are investing your time, energies, or indeed your reputation on supporting, openly or not, one particular group, then you are devolving a certain amount of power. Again, the Qatari example does leap to mind in terms of a state that, whether it's with the Ikhwan or Jabhat al-Nusra, these sorts of groups, that has associations with these groups, and the ramifications have been relatively harsh for the reputation of the wider state. One sort of so what is that, you know, it's good to see that the GCC is engaging more and more in a joined up strategic thinking. You know, the tactical differences will remain, but as the conclusions have already been reached, you know, the level of sort of disunity in different groups being supported in Libya or wherever, Syria or wherever, you know, it can't go on, and that's good to see. Part of this is also to do with developing indigenous capabilities. You know, the diplomatic academy here, it's a good thing to see. It's the same thing in Doha, giving Gulf states, you know, more, as I say, of your own capacity, so you're not as beholden. I mean, we're all beholden to a degree on the interlocutors we use, but lessening that is important. And the last, very last thing I'll say is that, forgive me using the example of Qatar again, but this is what I feel I know best. You know, I think there's a sense of Qatar felt that it could intervene in the Arab Spring on several occasions. It had the opportunity, it felt secure in the state, it had the financial or whatever resources, and it had the desire, so it could. I'm not sure whether enough pause for thought, there was enough of a pause for thought as to whether it should, if you see what I mean, about the second and third order ramifications of what happens. The ultimate, you do this, what's going to happen? How is that going to play out? As opposed to just sort of going ahead. I'll leave it there. Thank you.
All right, great. Thanks, David. Before I reach the questions, could I ask David Betts, please? David, could you please join us up front, just in case any of the questions go back to the first session. I mean, both of our speakers this afternoon have touched on a very sensitive issue, state support for non-state actors and the difficulties that causes. Theo, while we quickly have you, I would just like to ask your sort of reaction to this from the military strategy planning point of view. How do you deal with this issue of knowing that other states are actually funding and directly supporting these non-state actors, but yet your operations have to be against the non-state actor and not the other state?
So that was that was a particular problem for the United States and Afghanistan, because obviously the Pakistan intelligence service was providing support to the Taliban. And yet, at the same time, the United States was providing hundreds of millions of dollars in military aid every year to Pakistan. And so, in one sense, the United States was funding its own war against itself. And the evidence on this is absolutely compelling. So part of the research that I've done, one of the things that we did was we reconstructed the Taliban military campaign in Helmand Province based on 200 interviews with Taliban field commanders. So we had Afghan researchers go in on the ground, and in 2011, they interviewed 59 Taliban commanders, and we reconstructed what their campaign looked like. And then we ran that through U.S. intelligence to say, does this picture, is it similar to what you saw when you were providing the intelligence for ISAF? And they said yes. And what it clearly shows was the extent of Pakistan military support to the Taliban. It's just massive. And the problem, of course, is that the United States was dependent on Pakistan because it had to, Pakistan was the main logistical bridge for ISAF in Afghanistan. So you had both Pakistan providing logistical and training support to the Taliban across the border, and at the same time allowing the United States to provide logistical through Pakistan. And of course, what's going on is inside Pakistan, there are elements of the military that are see the necessity to combat the Taliban, because as later on they discovered they had their own problem with the Pakistan Taliban. And you have elements of the Pakistan army that see the importance of supporting the Taliban as a provide strategic depth in their struggle against India. And there was no solution, actually. I mean, basically the United States had to accept it was an imperfect situation. And this is the problem, and we touched on, and hopefully we'll come back to, I want to make some comments later about the law of armed conflict. But the problem, of course, is that whilst you can support a state engaged in a counterinsurgency to combat those insurgents, you cannot engage in cross-border attacks against a state that's supporting it. So it would have been illegal for the United States to use force against Pakistan. It would have been a clear breach of international law. Because they would not have been able to establish that there was self-defense at play. And so that's your basic fundamental challenge, actually. And so the lesson I take away from that is if you go into a counterinsurgency and you're facing a situation where there is host nation support, sorry, there is a foreign power supporting that insurgency, just realize you will never win. You will never defeat that insurgency militarily. You should start planning now for the peace talks. And then figure out how you can use force to limit the ability of the insurgents to set the terms of the negotiations and to bring them to the peace talks and keep them there. So in the case of Yemen, as long as Iran supports the Houthis, you'll never militarily defeat them. It's just impossible, actually. And there's not much you can do about it for obvious reasons. It would be illegal to use military force directly against Iran in that situation.
Yeah, but doesn't this, and I'll put this to all three speakers, the two speakers, and again to you, Theo, if we have the time. This creates a massive problem concerning the current rules of engagement, the current rules and practices of international law. We know full well that certain states are funding these armed non-state actors. We know they're responsible. And it's not just political support, it's material support, it's planning, it's actually engaging, it's actually being on the ground with them. Now, we talked about the various reasons why, you know, states will do this as part of their own foreign policy. But what do we do as the international community to respond to this? I mean, how do we deal with either the non-state actor on the ground, as Abu Qatar was discussing, or how do we deal with it as part of our overall security strategy? I mean, David, how would you, in your experience, how are we going to deal with this issue?
We're talking a lot about Iran and Yemen, and I'm not trying to insinuate that I'm an expert on this, but when we talk about Iran, we need to remember that Iran is many, many different things to many, many different people. It strikes me that it's extremely likely that there is some amount of material support or ideological support, whatever you want to describe, going from Iran to the Houthis. Okie doke, fine. But firstly, we need to have a judicious, a rigorous assessment of what it is and if it is actually making a difference on the ground. Maybe it is or maybe it isn't. But more to the point, Iran is, as I say, a multiplicity of actors. There are doubtless, maybe it's presumably at least, it's the Revolutionary Guard elements that want this sort of support to continue. But I imagine that President Rouhani and his clique do not. So presumably there's no answer to this kind of an issue. But presumably it's about supporting the moderates, as the phrase goes, supporting the people that we can. Engaging with President Rouhani would strike me, empowering him would strike me as a sensible way to go towards this end.
But again, Theo, go back to your point where you talked about how when governments start planning their strategy, they look to the big ticket items. They look to the conventional warfare elements. Are governments able to deal with this issue of material support for non-state actors as a military strategy on the ground?
If I can make a couple of points about international law, actually, which touch on this. Firstly, with response to when would it be legal to use force against a state that is providing material support to an insurgency on its home ground. Well, of course, the key case is the 1984 Nicaragua case. And we saw in the case of 2001, following the attacks in America, America had no problems, obviously, engaging in invading Afghanistan. And the Nicaragua case established that if a foreign power is providing material support to an insurgency, and the nature of the attack you face from that insurgency is of the same nature as an attack you would face from a state, then you can use force in self-defense. What was interesting was the innovation of the Bush administration in 2002 when they published the National Security Strategy. And in that, they claimed a right of preventive use of force. And this is really important. So in the Carolina case of the mid-19th century, it was established that a state may use force in self-defense before it is attacked. This is called anticipatory self-defense. If you are just about to be attacked, there's an imminent threat of attack, you may legally use force first in self-defense. But the attack must be imminent. And this is called preemptive use of force in self-defense. What the United States did under the Bush administration in its national security strategy of 2002 is it claimed a right of preventive self-defense. It blurred the boundary between preemptive and preventive. And it said that we can use force preventively to stop a threat from emerging. There is no credible international lawyer that agrees with that position. And what was further interesting is that the United States claimed that right solely for itself. It said, we're the only country that you can be trusted not to abuse this right, because obviously it's a license to commit aggression. And of course, Iraq is a product of that thinking. So international law does not accept that at all. It's quite clear that the attack must be of a scale that would be similar to an attack by another state, but you may use force if the attack is imminent, but if it's not, you can't use force in advance. But I want to touch on the extension of the law of armed conflict, because this is really important, and we were talking earlier on about insurgents using illegal means in their form of warfare and engaging in lawfare. And the important point here is this is always a product of the tribunals from Yugoslavia and Rwanda in the 1990s. And what the tribunals determined was that all the laws that apply in state-on-state wars now apply on internal wars. And it's also now quite clear that every single law of armed conflict applies to every actor in that armed conflict because they're now customary. So no one escapes. But what's interesting is we've seen in Iraq and Afghanistan the extension of human rights law, which is quite unusual. So usually in a state of conflict, human rights law stops and the law of armed conflict takes over. But in Iraq and Afghanistan, human rights law was applied by the European Court of Human Rights in the conduct of detention operations by European militaries. That's really important. So now the biggest challenge European militaries now face when they engage in counterinsurgency is what to do with detainees. It's profoundly challenging for them because of human rights law. Now, so operationally, it raises a challenge for us in the conduct of operations because increasingly Western forces are legally constrained in what they can do. But your insurgents, they use that against you. So they hide behind civilians. They use civilians as shields. They engage in attacks from hospitals and from schools. And you can't retaliate against those targets because they're civilian targets. This is lawfare. And that's really challenging. The point I want to make is it's also to our advantage. And in two ways. The rigorous application of the law of armed conflict forces us in how we conduct our operations to protect civilians and civilian targets. And that's really important because if at the end of the day what you're trying to do is win hearts and minds, you can't blow up people's houses and their schools, and you must minimize deaths to civilians. So it's really important and it's really actually in that sense helpful that we are rigorously held to account by the laws of armed conflict. And so I think a concept that was quite useful developed by General McChrystal when he took over command of ISAF was he developed this idea of courageous restraint. He said what's really important in how ISAF conducts counterinsurgency is we take risk on our shoulders. As soldiers, we take the risk on our shoulders, even if it means that we take casualties, but we protect civilians. That's really, really important. And that was controversial because a lot of US military and other militaries felt we should be able to return fire if necessary, but actually it was very important. But also it seems to me it's very important because now big emphasis is on security force assistance, training of host nation police and army, host nation security forces. And it's really important that we provide the training in the law of armed conflict. So I think actually what it is not unfair for insurgents to say, we don't know what the law of armed conflict is. You know, our own military need extensive training to make sure they understand what the rules of engagement are. And right now, by the way, many insurgent groups, if they're classed as terrorist organizations, it's illegal under U.S. federal law for you to provide them with training in the law of armed conflict. You are actually breaking U.S. federal law. So in fact, there's a fair case to be said that we should be providing training to insurgent groups so that they can apply the laws of armed conflict.
All right, great, thanks. Professor Fahmy,
please. Thank you. بدي أن أعلق على بعض الأفكار التي طرحت. يعني الحرب في أفغانستان ربما تكون لها مبرراتها ومشروعيتها، لكن يتساءل عن ما هي المبررات القانونية لشن الحرب على العراق، والمجتمع الدولي يعني متفق تماما على أنه لا يوجد هناك تبرير قانوني ولا قرار دولي أممي من مجلس الأمن لهذه الحرب. وحق الدفاع عن النفس وفق ما ضمن الميثاق المادة 51 من ميثاق الأمم المتحدة، هناك حالات معينة أنه تتعرض الدولة إلى عدوان مباشر، رغم أنه القانون الدولي اختلف في الحقيقة في تحليل ما هو العدوان. ومع ذلك فإن إذا يسمح لي الأستاذ الفاضل الكريم، الدفاع عن النفس والضربات الاستباقية، والضربات الاستباقية في الحقيقة لا يوجد لها تعريف قانوني، وإنما لها يعني دوافع سياسية. يعني وهذا هو معروف، يعني استباق الضربة تحسب العدوان بالرد عليه قبل وقوعه، هذه الضربة الاستباقية. وأيضا يعني أثيرت مسألة جدل حول أنه يعني ما من أين تأتي الضربة، من أين تأتي الضربة، وما هي الجهة التي توجه مثل هذه الضربة. وبالتالي علينا أن نضرب، نستبق الحدث قبل أن توجه إلينا الضربة. ولهذا لما انقسمت دول مثلا محور الشر في زمن كلينتون، كانت هناك يعني هناك تبرير سياسي وليس تكييف قانوني للعمل العسكري في توجيه هذه الضربات. وحقوق الإنسان، وجميعنا حقيقة يعرف أن حقوق الإنسان هي حقوق لها طبيعة سياسية، وكانت المنفذ والمدخل لتبرير كثير من الحروب. وحتى الدول اللي تم التدخل فيها لأغراض إنسانية هي خضعت لمفهوم التحالف الدولي وليس لمفهوم الأمن الجماعي الذي يحمي حقوق الإنسان. فضلا عن ذلك، إن القانون الدولي الإنساني يتضمن الحالات التي ينبغي أن نتدخل فيها إنسانيا، يعني مو بالضربة. وأيضا أنا أتساءل أن قضية سوريا، يعني ألا تستحق سوريا أن نتدخل فيها إنسانيا؟ وأيضا ليبيا في الوقت الحاضر. يعني إذا المسألة يعني دائما القاعدة القانونية تخضع للتكييف السياسي في حدود معينة وفي أوقات معينة وليس على الدوام. شكرا لك.
Great, thank you very much for that. And we almost need to have another session on the international law side of it, because Professor Theo raised a very interesting point on the laws of war. That's the international law governing when you can enter into combat operations. And I would argue that right now we don't have a sufficient framework. We can only act when there's a threat to international peace and security, when the Security Council authorizes it. The Security Council is proving unable or unwilling to authorize armed conflict to deal with some of these non-state actors, and this is becoming a real problem. And of course, this then has a knock-on effect to the laws of armed conflict, a different body of law, the international humanitarian law, and we can only reiterate the points that were made this morning by Elias and Professor Theo's points, that everybody is bound by this. There's absolutely no excuses, no questions, but trying to ensure the non-state actors adhere to it is proving very difficult, and in turn this impacts our ability to actually engage with these non-state actors. So there's a very complex area there. There's a lot more discussion on the legal side of it.
أول شيء مساء الخير ما دام تعدينا الساعة 12 للحضور وللمحاضرين ولك مستر ديفيد. أنا محمد سعيد الهاملي من وزارة الخارجية مدير إدارة التعاون الدولي. سعدت أني أخذ الميكروفون بعد هذه المحاضرات الجيدة لأعطي مداخلة، وأتمنى من المحاضرين في المستقبل أن يأخذون بعض النقاط المهمة إذا يبون يتكلمون مع مشاكلنا في الشرق الأوسط. النقطة الأولى حقيقة أنا يعني متفاجئ وعندي كونفيوز أن نتكلم عن المجموعات النظامية والمجموعات غير نظامية ونربط النظامية به قوات مسلحة لها سيادة في الدولة والقوات الغير نظامية وهي الإرهابيين. يعني نحن الآن نتكلم عن مقابلة القوات النظامية مع مجموعات إرهابية، أما إذا تكلمنا الغير نظامية فأعتقد أن نميل إلى الأربعينات والخمسينات عند قيام الثورات من أمريكا إلى أوروبا إلى الوطن العربي، وهذه كانت لها شرعية، ولهذا استقلت الدول وأصبحت دول لها الآن معترف بها المجتمع الدولي من كوبا إلى 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 جميع الأقطار اللي هي تحررت.
شرعية سياسية وليست قانونية.
أتفق معك سيد عبد القادر. إذن الموضوع وما فيه لما نتكلم عن هالموضوع، نحن نتكلم اليوم عن لا يوجد قانون دولي. إذن نحن نقول أن بداية الحرب بغض النظر ضد قوات نظامية أو غير نظامية هي أساسها الفشل في الحل السياسي، والحل السياسي هو تغننا وتلزمه التشريعات الدولية المعترف بها في منظمتنا الدولية وهي مجلس الأمن. مجلس الأمن فشل أن يصدر قرار من الثمانينات لحد الآن في حل أي مشكلة في الشرق الأوسط وأبدأها من الأساس. إذن ظهور هذه المنظمات بدأت باتخاذ قرار في أفغانستان من المجاهدين، والمجاهدين هذيلا كانوا يحاربون الروس بأيضا تمويل عربي وأجنبي، تخبر عنه أن هذه المجاهدين تحولوا إلى منظمات إرهابية تمثلت في القاعدة بعد رجوعها إلى الوطن العربي ثم تفرعت إلى أفرع. إذن غزو أفغانستان من قبل الاتحاد السوفيتي كان غير شرعي، ومجاهبته بالمجاهدين خلقت هذا. ثم انتهى الأمر إلى غزو العراق بعد ذلك، وأيضا الغزو هذا نتج عنه داعش وبعض المنظمات اللي نحن اليوم نعاني منها، وأيضا بعد ذلك أيضا تفرعت أو نشطت القاعدة من جديد أيضا بدعم أجنبي، أدى إلى أروح إلى حروب إسرائيل إن كانت 81 ولا 2006، ونتج عنها أيضا منظمات إرهابية منها مثلا حزب الله. وهذا إذا نظرنا إلى أساس هذا الموضوع أيضا هو من أفغانستان إلى العراق إلى لبنان، هو أيضا هناك هذه المنظمات تقوم بالنيابة عن دول هي أيضا موجودة في المنظمة الدولية، ولأن المجتمع الدولي لم يقدر أن يواجه الدولة مثل إيران بالقوانين ويقطع الريسورسز أو التمديد لهذه الأفرع الغير نظامية، نحن اليوم نعترف بإيران أن تشارك في حل ما قادمت عليه مثل الموضوع النووي ومثل إعلام المحادثات في سوريا، وأيضا من يحاول أن يجرها إلى المحادثات في اليمن. فهذا يعني موضوع أعتقد أن نحن اليوم لابد أن نحن كمنظمة عربية كمراكز دراسات في الوطن العربي أن ننظرها بعين الاعتبار إذا نبقى نتكلم عن أسس وجذور اللي قلت عنها عبد القادر، ومن أين من أنشأ هذه المنظمات وكيف طلعت على الوجود والآن هي تسبب المشكلة الرئيسية. نجي إلى حرب اليمن. حرب اليمن أعتقد أنها هي أيضا حرب شرعية، واستخدمت عبد القادر زي ما قلت أنها هي عبارة عن استباقة لتخفيف التهديد على دول مجلس التعاون وخاصة السعودية، وأن تشريحها جاء من خلال قبول مناداتها من قبل الشرعية.
اسمح لي فقط حتى لا تفوتني المداخلة مالتك، هي ليست استباقية، القوة
بس أكمل لك
العربية
بس أكمل لك
بالتدخل باليمن هي ليست استباقية، وإنما هي ضمن الشرعية السياسية والقانونية.
بتكمل بس بكمل،
لأن الاستباقية ترى بها
بكمل طال عمرك.
يعني احنا وجهتنا إسرائيل ضربات تسمى بالضربات الاستباقية،
بس
لا يحكمها القانون الدولي.
بس أكمل النقطة معك، يمكن توجد لي فيها انصاف معك. هي استباقية من حيث أول شيء نحن عندنا حلفاء الحلفاء هذا تم اخبارهم ان هذا التهديد التدخل الحوثي والانقلاب الحوثي شكل تهديد على دول مجلس التعاون وخاصه الصديقه والشقيقه السعوديه، استجابوا لهذه التنشن، ثم شرعيه طلب الحكومه اليمنيه على الانقلاب بازاله الانقلاب، ثم مبادرات دول مجلس التعاون وايضا الجامعه العربي. فنحن نعتبر حربنا في اليمن ليس حرب مع غير نظاميه، هي مع حرب مع قوه احتلت الدوله واستخدمت قوه الدوله من حرب الكترونيه الى قوات جويه الى مدفعيه الى صواريخ الى ما اشبه ذلك. اذا جينا نتكلم عن حقوق الانسان، انا اتفق معك عبد القادر ان موضوع حقوق الانسان هو موضوع زي القم او زي العلوشه، يمكن انك تاخذها ولكن اذا رميت تدوس فيها واذا سرطتها وجعك بطنك. فنحن نعتبر ان حقوق الانسان والمساعدات الانسانيه او الانفراستراكشر اليمن محافظ عليه من خلال استخدام قوه بطريقه مدروسه وعقيده نظاميه تتماشى مع المدارس الغربيه، وايضا تسليح دقيق وذكي، وهو ايضا ما يستخدمونه في بعض البلدان. ناخذ موضوع اين نحن الان في هذا موضوع النظاميه وغير النظاميه. اعتقد ان نحن نحتاج الى ادوات اخرى لقتال هذه المنظمات غير الرهيبة، منها مكافحه التطرف، منها مكافحه التطرف ودراسه جذوره، وايضا نحكي مع اخواننا في الجانب الاخر اللي يتكلمون باللغه الانجليزيه ما نتكلم به باللغه العربيه، ان تكون بيننا سينكرونايزيشن او يكون بيننا توافق وتجانس حتى نطلع من هذه المشكله، وليس استخدام القوه بالشكل الرئيسي في مكافحه التطرف او مكافحه الارهاب. وشكرا.
Do you have any more to respond?
Can I?
Please.
انا اشكرك استاذ يعني لمداخلاتك الجيده وانتباهك العالي لموضوعات حساسه ودقيقه جدا. الحل السياسي تفضلت بهذا الموضوع، يعني التدخل في بعض الدول اللي يعتقد من قبل النظام المجموعة الدولية أو من قبل مجلس الأمن أن هذا النظام هو نظام يقمع الحريات ويتعارض ويقوم بسياسات إلى آخره. يا أستاذ، هذا الموضوع يعني موضوع ويعتقد بأن هذا النظام يسبب خطورة على السلم والأمن الدوليين. أنا أحكي لك بالقانون الآن، الفقرة 37 من ميثاق الأمم المتحدة وإلى حد الفقرة 45 تنظم كيف يمكن استخدام نظرية الأمن الجماعي في مواجهة الدول التي تهدد السلم والأمن الدوليين. أمن جماعي، وهناك فرق ما بين القوات اللي تتشكل في إطار الأمن الجماعي وما بين ما احنا نتحدث به قوات التحالف، التحالف الدولي او الى اخره. هذه مو امن جماعي، هذه عباره عن تحالف ما بين، وقانون الناظم يختلف عن نظام الامن الجماعي، لان احكام الفصل السابع من الميثاق لها تفصيلات معينه، وبعدين تبدا بالحل الدبلوماسي الوساطه الى اخره. هذا جانب. الجانب الاخر، هذه المشاكل اللي تحدث بالداخل، يعني التدخل لاغراض انسانيه مو بالفزعه، يعني يجي يقول لك والله اغراض انسانيه، لا. اولا انه تكون هناك يعني طرف وسيط لحل التفاوض. ثانيا حقوق المدنيين تحفظ. ثالثا الجماعات المسلحه تنحل وتشكل احزاب، يعني مو بتبقى شايله السلاح ضد الدوله، يذبون السلاح يرمون السلاح وتشكل احزاب، واحزاب يقرها قانون الاحزاب في داخل الدوله. يعني المساله بيها تنظيم، يعني مو انه شكل تحالف ضد الى اخره. انا مو دفاعا على انظمه، لكن انا دفاعا عن كيفيه فهم النص القانوني وتكييفه لاغراض سياسيه. والقانون الدولي حقيقه مليء بهذه المسائل، وانا عندنا حالات كثيره يعني في المنطقه العربيه بهذا الاتجاه. حرب اليمن انا اعتبرها ضروره تاريخيه لإعادة مكانة الحق العربي في السياسات، يعني يكفي احنا نبقى يعني موضع للفعل دون ان نكون يعني مصدر للفعل. وبالعكس يعني هذه تفعيل معاهد الدفاع العربي والدفاع الدفاع العربي المشترك المادة 51 من معاهدة الدفاع العربي المشترك، أنه يكون جهد عربي لمواجهة حالات التدخل. وأنا أتمنى حقيقة أن تتبلور هذه الصيغة التحالفية إلى أن تكون عمل مؤسسي يعني في إطار جامعة الدول العربية. وإحنا عندنا منظمة يعني منظمة إقليمية جامعة الدول العربية، وهي أولى وأحرى بمناقشة الشأن العربي قبل أن يتخذ صفة دولية وتتدخل بها الأغراض الدولية. سوريا يعني روسيا من دخلت إلى سوريا أستاذ يعني هيك هالشكل، تفاهم يعني تفاهم واتفاق أبدا. حدود الدور الروسي أو حركة روسيا على الأرض، هم ما استخدموا الأرض، قوات جوية تقصف، وهناك تفاهم مع إسرائيل أنه حدود المجال الجوي اللي تعمل به السلاح الجوي الروسي، وأيضا الأردن المجال اللي تعمل به، ومن ثم وبعدين ما نستهدفه يعني ما استهدفه ترى مو داعش، ونقراها بالصحف، هم استهدفوا الجماعات المقاومة ضد النظام. وداعش وقت وداعش يعني بالمناسبة ترى من بداية الثورة هاي في آذار 2011 ترى وقفت ويا النظام السوري وصدروهم للعراق، تلاحظ شلون. وداعش أنا أتفق معك أنه يعني
I'm going to stop you there just so we can get some more questions, but thank you very much. Second question here please.
عليكم. يعقوب علي، صحفي في جريدة الاتحاد. أول شيء أشكر مركز ترندز على إتاحة الفرصة هذه، مع أني كنت أتمنى أن المؤتمر يكون يمتد لأكثر من يوم. عموما ندخل في الموضوع حتى ما نأخذ وقت كثير. عندي تحفظ بسيط على مسألة الخوض في مسألة دعم إيران المباشر لما سمي هنا بالجماعات غير الحرب غير المتماثلة بين جماعات منظمة وجيوش تقليدية وجيوش أخرى. نحن نتحدث اليوم، عنوان المحاضرة هو مستقبل أمن الخليج. مستقبل أمن الخليج لا يمكن إلقاء الضوء عليه وتسليط الضوء عليه وفق المعيار العالمي. ممكن نتحدث في فرنسا تحدث عملية إرهابية من شخص أو شخصين، ممكن في دولة أخرى، ولكن في الخليج نتحدث عن جيش يمني متحالف مع ميليشيا إرهابية، نتحدث في لبنان عن حزب الله عبارة عن جيش نظامي ما ممكن اعتباره عمل أو جزء عمليات إرهاب أو خلينا نقول ميليشيات إرهابية بسيطة تتكون من أفراد معينين. فإحنا ياريت كنا نركز على مسألة إيران، ونعيد السؤال اللي حاول ضيفنا الكريم أعتقد اللي إذا ما خاني الاسم الدكتور روبرتس، أنه يقول لك أنه المكون الداخلي لإيران يختلف في مسألة، فإحنا محتاجين لتقييم إضافي لمسألة إيران باعتبارات أنه في محافظين وفي متشددين وفي وفي وفي. الموقف الإيراني واضح جدا، لما إيران تحرك بوارج حربية فيها أسلحة باتجاه اليمن، لما أعضاء في البرلمان الإيراني يتكلمون مباشرة عن السعودية والحوثيين ودعم مباشر، أعتقد أنه إيران يعني واضحة وصريحة في مسألة. فمسألة أنه إظهار ما يحدث في الخليج على أنه حروب بين جماعات تقليدية، حروب نظامية بين جيش نظامي وجيوش غير نظامية، أعتقد أنه تعبير غير واضح. وأتمنى إعادة السؤال مرة أخرى للضيف اللي هو كيف يمكن مواجهة الدعم المباشر والعلني اللي تحصل عليه المنظمات الإرهابية من قوى إقليمية أولها إذا كنا نتحدث عن منطقة الخليج إيران.
But it's a very good point. I mean, David, I'm putting that to you first because you were looking at the example of a state supporting and being part of non-state actors. From your sort of research, do you have any lessons for those states that are at the other end of it, who aren't sort of appreciative or don't want to see this behavior because it does threaten security?
Plainly, I mean, it comes down to this, I think, again, going back to the specific example of Iran, it comes back to looking at the motivations of the state and working out how you can change those, because it's pivotally important to the motivation, of course. And the idea that's often put forward, it's, you know, makes a lot of sense, is it's to do with the ideology, 1979, Velayat Faqih, these ideas. But to my mind, that's not really important, in the sense that, you know, when it suits Iran, they will say those words and follow those words, and it's a political, you know, the politicians are politicians. They will say something and do something different another time. So in the 1980s, in the height of the Iranian revolution, Khomeini was still there. death to America, etc., etc., who was one of Iran's central trading partners in the region? Israel. Because they needed spare parts. You know, Vlai Faqih, all the rhetoric in the world was trumped completely by pragmatism. And so I take a similar line now. I mean, it's part of it, we shouldn't ignore it, but we need to look at, again, look at things from Tehran. I think the Gulf is a fairly scary place from Tehran. But General Petraeus, a few years ago, said that the Emirati Air Force by itself could easily wipe out the Iranian Air Force. This is to say nothing of the 150 plus, you know, latest generation Saudi aircraft and the other 100 or so kicking around further north and south in the Gulf. I know that we need to talk about the asymmetric ideas, don't get me wrong. But if America has just come in and invaded a country on its border and there are bases north, south, east, west, it strikes me that, as I say, the view from Iran, this is what we need to do. We need to try to put ourselves in some other shoes, if you see what I mean. The view from Iran is a bit concerning at times. And Hezbollah, I mean, I don't know enough about the politics in that part of the world, but Hezbollah strikes me as deterrence against Israel. It strikes me as, I know it's offensive, don't misunderstand me, and the point is well taken about it's almost transcended from a non-state actor. But that's what I think that is, you know?
Yeah. And again, this goes back to some of Theo's earlier points of the difficulties we face in the current international legal frameworks. We do have a law of state responsibility that says when a state violates norms of international law, they are responsible. And we're seeing this more and more with actual material evidence on the ground. But yet, to go back to the point that was made by Professor Abdelkader, we don't have the political will sometimes to ensure that this international law is implemented. So I think the evidence is fairly clear, but why don't we see the Security Council, the powerful states stepping up? And that's a larger sort of strategic question. We have another question just here. Yeah.
سؤالي موجه للبروفيسور عبد القادر. بما أننا نواجه في الوقت الراهن جماعات غير نظامية ومن الصعب جدا أن نحن نواجههم في الأدوات والوسائل العسكرية بحيث أن هي يعني بما أسماها بعض المتحدثين في الجلسة السابقة بأنها وسائل تقليدية. فلماذا لم يتم استخدام الوسائل الحديثة مثل الحرب السيبرالية من قبل الدول العربية وبخاصة الدول الخليجية حتى الآن، بالرغم من أن لا سيما يعني أن الجماعات الغير نظامية مثل داعش هي وايد قوية في الحرب الإلكترونية؟ فيعني شو المانع أن لين الحين ما استخدمت الدول الخليجية والدول العربية الوسائل التكنولوجية؟
شكرا لك. شكرا.
Okay, before we, I just want to take a couple more questions. These gentlemen just in front here. I know there's tons of questions. We're going to struggle to get there, but briefly, please.
شكرا جزيلا. حقيقة المتحدثين تطرقوا إلى أمور كثيرة. وأنا ما أرد أرجع لأن كان عندي سابقا بالجلسة الأولى تساؤلات وتعقيب، ولكن هسه راح أتطرق بشكل سريع. أنا حسب اعتقادي يعني أضرب مثل بسيط. إحنا عندما نجد شخص مريض يروح لطبيب، الطبيب الذكي الشاطر راح يجي يبحث عن حالة سبب المرض، يروح أكو قسم طبيب اللي ما يعرف زين راح ينطي عدد من الأدوية واحد بعد واحد واحد بعد واحد إلى أن المرض يتفاقم، بعدين الأدوية ما تفيد، والطبيب الجيد راح يروح باتجاه تحاليل وغيرها وغيرها وزرع لهذا إلى أن حدد الجرثومة ينطيها العلاج تنتهي الموضوع. حاليا منظمات هذه الإرهابية اللي موجودة هي مرض منتشر في هذه المكانات، ولكن هذا المرض مثل ما اتطرقت قسم كثير من الإخوان إلى أسبابه إلى دوافعه، ولكن هناك حالة أساسية أنه وراء كل هالمنظمات الإرهابية الموجودة أكو قوى أخرى موجودة، قوى خارجية، قوى متمكنة تدير هاي المنظمات. إذا نحن بدل ما نجي نقاتل هاي المنظمات ونستنزف كل طاقاتنا، المفروض بينا الأجدر أن نتحول إلى المكانات الأساسية، إلى المصادر الأساسية. وأجيب مثل بسيط، بالعراق من سنة 1961 إلى 1975 كانت اكو عمليات تمرد موجوده عبر اربع حكومات، زمن كريم قاسم وعبد السلام عارف وعبد الرحمن عارف، وبعدين جاء موضوع صدام حسين. اخر شيء توصلت الحكومه بعد ما استنزفت عبر هاي السنين الطويله انه هو المصدر الرئيسي لتغذيه الحاله هم ايران. راحوا اتفقوا مع شاه ايران، وقعوا اتفاقيه الجزائر، خلال 3 أيام الموضوع انتهى. ايران ذبوا السلاح والموضوع انتهى. اذا من نروح احنا على المصدر، هذه المنظمات ما جايه من الخيال ولا نزلت من القمر. هاي منظمات لها من يديرها، اكو عقول تديرها، اكو امكانات موجوده كبيره، اكو قوى موجوده فاعله بالعالم، ليس في المنطقه فقط وانما بالعالم. فعلينا ان نتوجه الى هاي المكانات ونفتش عنها ونروح بقرارات قد يجوز منها الامم المتحده انه حتى نوصل الى هالنتيجه هذه، ونجبر هذه الدول انه ما ترعى ولا يعني تساعد هذه المنظمات، ومن يساعدها يتحمل عقوباتها، عقوبات كبيره عليها. اما الدول ترعاها وتساعدها تحت اغطيه مختلفه، يعني بالعراق مثلا، انا عراقي اعرف الحاله ودارسها جيد. بالعراق حاليا اكو داعش يرتكب جرائم حق الناس وحق الدنيا كلها، وبالمقابل اكو ميليشيات، ميليشيات تقوم بنفس الدور مال داعش. ميليشيات رافعه شعار وعلمها مواليه لولايه الفقيه، مو سرا يعني، يقول احنا ما ندير للحكومه ولا لنا علاقه بالحكومه، احنا تابعين ولايه الفقيه. وهاي المنظمات، هاي الجمعيات، العفو، الميليشيات تقتل وتهجر وتدمر مناطق كامله مسحتها من الارض، ما حد يتكلم عنها.
صحيح.
فهنا النقطه الحقيقيه، هاي قضايا اكو موجوده على الارض، احنا بحاجه انه احنا نريد نقضي على الارهاب نرجع إلى مصادر الدعم الأساسية اللي هي تمول الإرهاب. إذا ما رحنا عليها راح نبقى يعني نعالج معالجاتنا كلها راح تكون هامشية ما لها قيمة، نستنزف طاقتنا، تستنزف كليا، حتى مواردنا تستنزف، وما نقدر نقضي على هذه الحالة. مع الشكر.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much first of all for speaking this afternoon. I'm a historian by trade, so I tend to take the long view on all this. For me,
a long view and a very short comment, please.
I will try and do that. So for me, this is all slightly strange, perplexing when we talk about all where this addressing these non-state actors, the funding, et cetera, et cetera. For me, I see a massive case of people reinventing the wheel. Everyone's talking about this post-1979 world as being some strange and amazing, wonderful beast that no one's ever seen before. If we kind of go step back a generation and look at this and see the challenges that we're facing our parents and grandparents in this region, particularly I'm thinking of the UAE, but also, and the crucial states, but also Oman, we see Iraqi, Egyptian, Yemeni fundraising for Republican movements and nationalists whipping up insurrection throughout this region. And it seems to be a collective case of amnesia here where we've forgotten the tried and tested tools for combating this, which worked, and everyone's just forgotten them. And as I said, we need to reinvent the wheel for some reason. And for me, I don't understand why that is, because particularly in the UAE and Oman, they're the same people who are ruling the country that went through these problems 30, 40 years ago. But it seems to not be passed on to the younger generation. Anyway, that's just a comment. It's not really a question.
That's a good point.
I'm struck by it.
No, it is a good point. In discussing this stuff, we are looking at newer events, but some of the phenomenon we have seen throughout history. And that's why the first question that was raised about trying to perhaps use some more different modern ways of dealing with these root causes, the actual sort of the funders behind it, the ones that are leading to these diseases, might be useful. But you're absolutely right, we have lessons throughout history. Are we going to start learning the lessons? Does anybody want to take on a response to that, of sort of using sort of different tools to respond to an old problem? Theo.
Yeah, I do want to talk about this, different tools. Just quickly to say, that question about reinventing the wheel, this of course comes from a War Studies alumni. And it is certainly true that there is a lot that's new, technology, there's a lot that's new, there's a lot that's not. And in War Studies, whenever myself, people like myself and David, we go to seminars, particularly people from the government, and they talk about all this new stuff, we go, no, most of it's not new. And it's certainly true that states and militaries and organizations learn and forget, learn and forget. So, you know, we're relearning lessons that we'd learned in the mid-20th century. But on this business about new tools and old tools, I mean, firstly, on the cyber side, and this is a very good point, Daesh is very good at cyber. Its cyber operations are very, very good. It's very agile. And one of the problems that states face is that if you know, anyone who interacts with the state and public affairs department, you know how cumbersome it is. Right? It's very cumbersome for states to put out public affairs statements. The whole machinery of state is about being very careful in what states say and do. Whereas Daesh can do propaganda very fast. And so we're always catching up. And if you're a state in a coalition, you have to coordinate your public message with that of all your partners. It makes it even more laborious. And then to make matters even worse, this is one of the reasons why Daesh is so good at what we call STRATCOM, strategic communications, is they have much better cyber warriors than we do. So I can't speak for Gulf states, but in the case of the United States, the cyber people the United States use, the Department of Defense, are contractors hired under a Department of Defense contract where they can't pay them very much. So put it this way, Walt Disney has better cyber defenses than the US Department of Defense, guarantee you, right? And Daesh has better cyber warriors than the US Department of Defense does. And that's a combination that they have better technical expertise, but also they can make public statements faster than states can. But old tools help too, though. And I was mentioned earlier on to somebody here, when it comes to the tactical side of things on the information side, Western states are much better than Daesh and insurgencies. We have much better tactical communications than they do. We find it very easy to break into their tactical communications and find their people. And actually, some of the capabilities we developed for peer-in-peer warfare, which is high-precision strikes, airstrikes, are proven very good at targeting high-value targets when we break their communications. So in terms of strategic communications, insurgencies tend to be better than states. But in terms of tactical communications and our ability to infiltrate insurgent tactical networks and eviscerate insurgent tactical command and control, and there's lots of lessons from Afghanistan. I've seen lessons of how this works. States tend to have much greater capability than insurgents. It's a balanced picture.
Right. Professor Fan, anything you'd like to add?
Yeah, thank you. السؤال حضرتك على الاتصالات و او يعني الفضاء الالكتروني وحسب ما فهمت انه ليش ما يعني سبب عدم قيام هذه المجموعات بهذه العمليات حقيقه يعني ما وصلت الى هذا المستوى واذا كان بامكانها تصل يعني هذه نظام معقد يعني ضرب المراكز الاتصالات و النظام الدفاعي وهجوم القوات المسلحة والآخرين لكن استخدموها دول يعني مثلا الصين بال 2009 أكو منطقة يعني عطلوها تماما 9 ملايين واحد فقدت الاتصالات استخدمتها إسرائيل لتعطيل البرنامج النووي الإيراني يعني بعض الوقت استخدمتها روسيا في في 2009 في حرب اعتقد مع الشيشان او شيء من القبيل هذا نعم جورجيا نعم جورجيا هذه يعني نادرة الحدوث يعني بس على مستوى بس هي ممكن ان تكون يعني تدرس ضمن الحروب المصنفة بالحروب المستقبل وهي خطيرة حقيقة يعني بهذا المجال بس هذه المجموعات ما أتصور أنها وصلت إلى هذا المستوى المتقدم يعني هم يستخدمون التكنولوجيا مو يستخدمون.
Do you have anything else to add?
Thank you.
Okay, good. David, any final sort of?
No, I've mentioned my points.
Okay. I do apologize for that, but I'm well aware that we have run over time, and I see a number of people have to go. So I'm going to draw things to a conclusion here. However, all of our speakers are very happy and very willing to discuss these issues with you further. But before you go, I just want to extend my thanks to everybody who has come today. Extend my thanks to Dr. Ahmed, to the staff at Trends, to our various crews here that have helped us out. I think it's been a very successful event. I'd like to thank our speakers here in the second session for their contributions. Thank everybody in the audience. I do apologize if we didn't get to your question, for your contributions, and please join us for lunch. Thank you.